Maar Paas is door de stress van de volgende dag van de IRS. Past, present in the future. So I will discuss, of course, not our possibilities, because I've seen that there are lectures on the future. John Marshall will discuss the crystal ball at the end of the meeting. I will have a few slides on that. I will discuss also briefly some new technologies, other speakers with more expertise. We will discuss that in detail later on. We are here to honor Alfred Jolstram, and as I said, so we are all using the Switland every time, every day we are using that human model, and all of the IRL power calculations, they're still based on the theories developed by him so many years ago. Past. How did it go in the past? Here you see Marcus Tullius Cicero, and what was he doing when he was 60 years or older? He had presbyopia problems. Because he worked in medicine, never had them, because he was a high major. He could read till his 86 years. So Cicero saw that, he hired a slave, and the slave did the job for him. But as we know, that's too expensive that being. So we have to find new solutions. We found spectacles that were helpful for us. When did it start? How long do we know spectacles? They were invented probably in Venice. They moved into Murano because there was a risk of fire, so they brought the glass industry to the island in 1280. And the first time it was mentioned was by two monks in Firenze, 1305-1313, in the sermon. They mentioned for the first time that there existed something like spectacles to make everything easier. First, they started with spectacles for presbyopia and hyperopia. Then myopia spectacles came out 1450, and astigmatism correction much, much later on. Who was the inventor of the bifocal spectacles? The inventor of the bifocal spectacles was Benjamin Franklin. Franklin was a mathematician, he was a diplomat, he was one of the most important people working on the independence of the United States. He was also a writer, an artist. And what did he do? He had a lot of problems because he lived to his age 84 or 86. He was myopic, he had reading problems, he had to switch glasses. So it said, okay, let's cut the glass into two halves. I will use the upper half to see for distance. I'll glue it together with the lower half that's useful for reading, and I will glue it together. And these are the Franklin bifocal spectacles. You can see the nice separation line. So he was happy, and he could function till age 86. Then came the progressive glasses, but that's more recently, of course, around 1960. Progressive glasses with the progressive, without this line, without this separation. It was picked up by American Optical, by Rodenstock, and by Zeiss. And then it's since 1972 that we knew the real values, the real progressive lenses that made it much easier, easier to adapt, and so on. And this was a real good solution for people who wanted to be able to read with only one pair of glasses. So the progressive lens, it was also discussed, the progressive contact lens that gives us the possibility to see clearly distant, intermediate and near vision, something we know about multifocal lenses, and it should be invisible. Aesthetically it had to be much better, and it was much better. That's the idea. Distance, intermediate, and near, everything should be correct, should be sharp, and you should not see a separation line. Progressive contact lenses were developed, we have heard that a few seconds ago. Let me show something. People don't want to get old, and when you get old, you have a presbyopia problem. Here I have a solution for that. I hope that we can play with the short movie. society fails.
Structures, the concentric rings on the back surface,
And it was also, it was based, the physics were based on principles developed by him already in the 18th century. Again, we have to go back. This guy developed the, we have the idea, he developed the physics and Trier used it, and they used it for their first multi-lens optimization. You know what this means, different microstructures. Some lenses have it on the whole, back to the posterior surface. Some lenses have it only on part of the posterior surface. Different reflectance, the refraction steps, and appropriate amount of light to near the distance, regardless of the lighting situation. Depending on the fact of the whole posterior surface is covered or not, the reading may be easier or less or more difficult, and that was the difference between the restore and the technisch lens. Did it work? Of course it worked, but the material was PMMA. The lenses had 6.5 millimeters, so we needed 6.57 millimeter opening. You had to cut nearly the line to half. You created astigmatism. There were a lot of papers on it, 2000. Here we have it too. We have in 2008 years review by Dick Lindstrom, 671 patients, again a review of ophthalmology, and we did around 200 of these eyes. They were satisfied at that time because people were less demanding, but we are talking 1987 and 1990, things like that. But of course it was not the final solution. And later Pharmacia and Pfizer developed the systems, the one-piece refractive lens. What happened with this technology? This diffractive technology, so the micro structures on the back surface, the optimization system, was sold by Trier because they stopped making it. They sold the technology to Alcon, and Arm developed the Restore 3 and Restore 4, and Pharmacia sold this technology to Abbott AMO, and then came out the technisch lens. Let's talk now about another approach of three-zone design. And here you can already see the three zones. That's the intermediate zone. It's only for the reading. It's distance. That's also distance. And here is an addition. It's a kind of refractive lens. And this is the reading zone. Inner and outer zones are powered for distance. Nord did important studies on that, 1992, 1993. Some publications, and we did about 60 IOLs in this study. The same thing, it was a PMMA lens, needed surgery, it created a lot of astigmatism. So again, not the final solution. And at that time, what happened during that period? The breaking up of the Soviet Union into 35 or 40 different independent states, and Operation Desert Storm, 1992, started Desert Storm during that period. New technologies came on, they improved it. Morphe developed three-zone designs. Some were developed for distance, part of it for near. When I got the distance dominant time, you know this, because other companies used it, are using it still now. When I had the distance dominance with the 70% distance light, and the other guy gets near dominant eye, where you have more light focused for near. The array lens was used several many years, specifically in the US, less in Europe, I suppose. It's a zone of progressive lens, different zones, and it came out in 1992. And then the development of the array lens was the zoom lens, a zone with refractive design. Already a lot of improvement because we had many problems with the array lens. The resume lens was better. We used it for the mix and match. One time we put the resume, and one time we put the technisch lens with the diffractive optics. And this is the resume lens by AMO Abbott. Here we have five zones, and alternately one for distance, one for near. And it created less glare and error than with the array lens. Here you see it more in too detail, and the explanation will go faster. Then we come to the present times with the Alcon development is the Restore lens, 3 and 4 diopters. The 4 diopters were added later on because it gave them better reading possibilities, specifically for close work. specifically for women, because as we will discuss later on, they keep perfectly close. The reading distance is different from the reading distance of a man. It's using the apodized, the old, the old principle, and then it came with the spheric version, with the yellow tinted and so on. And here you see the rings, but the rings are not on the whole surface of the lens, it's only 3.6 millimeters center of the optics. Then the Abbott developed it, they're using the rings on the whole posterior surface of the lens so that people have better reading possibility in darkness. It covers the entire posterior surface, it's pupil independent. The techniques have been used it for several hundreds of eyes. And they improved it, and then they came out with a one piece, and that's the lens as it is now, the ZMO, the one piece technique, full diffractive posterior surface. Yeah, in our series, we have two minor complications. We will present this 2013 at the AEO with ASCRS, with our group, and we have four out of the 52 they reported clear at night, who reported clear during the day. Spectacle independence with this lens was very high, 91%. And here, let's show you. Another possibility to make people happy, or unhappy, but we need the whole technician to catch it.
Accommodative lenses as well.
and was the principal position of the Sigaoptic, the Crystallized Tetraflex ICU. These lenses, as we know, as we have realized, they have little or limited effect outside the US. It's very strange, it's working much better in the US than outside the US. Like the optic shift principles, the basic mechanism is transmission by haptics of conductive force on the cerebellar body to the flexible lens. The lens is supposed to move by our accommodative effort. Design depends on the lens. The crystal lens were the first to launch these principles, ICU and the Sigaoptic lens. It's a different, that's a combination of a high plus and a negative, the high plus anterior and a negative posterior surface. The principle of described by Kohler, this is by contraction by our accommodative effort, by the ciliary muscle effort, the lens is supposed to move forward and to give so higher refractive power. Lens tech came out with an improvement of it. It's a blade lens. 606 eyes will be submitted to the FDA. We have the Synchrony by AMO. We already discussed it. That's how the lens looks like. 300 eyes are done worldwide. It will be worldwide about 1,300 and a submission of 300 in Europe. Submitted to the FDA shortly. And Dr. Chang will document objective change in refraction. The lens seems to move in the eye. So the effects and the results with the Synchrony lens were much better than with the Tetraflex and than with the Crystal lens. Now, how do we, what happened objectively? As I said, in the US it was much better than outside the US. Some Europeans measured it, and what were the outcomes? Sometimes the optic is supposed to move forward, sometimes when they measured it, sometimes it moved backward. How could it work? The maximum they could measure with the crystal lens is 0.5 diopter. Some of these lenses needed explantation. I have to explain two of them. They're getting encapsulated, fibrotic reaction, it's not an easy thing. There's no standardization. Now you have a Salzburg reading desk, you can standardize, but how do you standardize the reading possibilities? And look at what sort of pseudo accommodation. Was it really an effect of the lens? Was it a pseudo accommodative effect? The general trends, let's go further to this. The accommodative false assessments were also made. And here we're talking again about the accommodative lens. ICU, for example, supposed to capture the back, retain some elasticity, but in fact it's not true, it becomes immobile. The crystal lens supposed that the vitreous is in a non-compressible mass, but in fact the vitreous body of 50 and over disintegrates. It's not a non-compressible mass. Often it detaches and floats in the fluid filled cavity. How could the lens work? So in reality the lens did not work. The maximum they could find was 0.5, these accommodative lenses. We are using in the office, and my son is doing the surgery now, the ATLISA, the multifocal target by size. It's a single piece diffractive lens, incision size less than 2.1 millimeter. It's a preloaded lens. If you skip this, it gives you, it has three foci, a distant, an intermediate, and a near. And it's the first preloaded multifocal toric area. And you only need 2.1 millimeter open incision size. Realistic expectations for this kind of lenses, as we know, some neural adaptation is necessary. Your patient selection is very important. All of them have some problems. Photic phenomena heroes 5 to 10%. You have to discuss that with your patient, so you have to question your patient. I got in the pipeline a few of them, the Preussner lens, two magnets, one magnet in the lens, one magnet is implanted under the rectus muscles. He will submit it, he did already 10 eyes or something like that, and he will go to FDA with it. Powerful vision, fluid vision lens, has an effect of 5 diopter in 6 patients. Problem is it needs 9 millimeter opening. We will see how they come out, what the results will be. Dat is de lens, die xenootje, een big lens, de fluid is stored in the haptic. En bij de contraction, de fluid is displaced from the periphery to the center. So the center browses forward and creates the accommodative effect, which seems to be very important. Here you see close-up of this huge lens, 9 mm is the size for the moment. No lens dynamic curve. It's in the pipeline since about 10 years, I've heard about it 10 years ago. It's a combination of two lenses, it's placed in the sulcus, and again, it's based on a principle like the forward protrusion of a kind of silicone piston, that's a silicone piston, and it could create about 9 diopters effect. Only 15 partially sighted eyes are done till now, so they're working on it during more than 10 years, I suppose. No, only partially sighted eyes are done. Incision size again at the start, 11, because it was not 4, but now 5 and maybe 3.25. Huge, very important accommodative effect. Hoya will bring something new, Via will bring something new, and 4 slides of the future. What do we have to do to replace the lens of 60 years old by the lens of 20 years old? How can we do that? How can we bring an artificial, better functioning lens into an older eye? That's a problem. We have to solve that. Is this a new idea? Absolutely not. It's not a new concept because the first publication is 1964. 50 years ago, they already discussed that and said, oh, we want to do something like that. Experiments in refilling the lens. So they had already the idea. So it should be terribly difficult to reach the goal since they are working on it during 50 years. Again, we have seen it, we have shown too many slides, I know that. But there are too many to be good, too many solutions to be good. So which one is the good solution? What do we have to do to refill the lens? The mini-capsular axis, 1 mm hole, still in the micro-capsular axis to prevent leakage, because if we bring something like a silicone material into the eye, it should remain there, it should not change, because still the capsule should become clear, so that's the most important challenge. Prevention of PCO. The act has to be avoided, because then you will create leakage on the injected gel. Effect will be zero. Maybe we need another approach. As you see, the bicycle, as we know it today, it was discovered in 1839, but the train was there since 1803. Because why? Because people said it's impossible. When you have only on two wheels, you can never stand upright or be in equilibrium. You should fall. So finally, they brought it. So why? Why did they invent the train before the invention of the bicycle, which is much more simple? Maybe we have to look at some birds' eyes. What are they doing? Certain diving birds have a method of altering the curvature of the front surface of the lens. And they are doing that like that. They are protruding in system, a kind like a dynamic curve, like the new lens system. They are protruding the anterior surface of the lens into the anterior channel, and like that they can generate 80 diopters of extra power. They are using the Bruch's muscle. Bruch's muscle, which is much more important for these diving birds than for men. They are using this system. They will be here for maybe another 10 or 15 years before they reach the goal. Eventually, it is the new country, but we'll need more time. Thank you for listening.